Thanks, Rakesh. I am his batch, like you said, 2003. And like I said, we started govasool.com. I worked in PNG for 3 years, and then I moved to the UK. I worked there for about 3 years. And then 2008, I came back to India. We had a dream start. One of those stories where with 7-slider presentation, we raised $250,000 in the Valley and came back to India. And then I quit my job. So money in the wallet before we came back. It's been an incredible journey, though, for the last 6.5 years since this journey has begun. Govasool.com was, incidentally, India's first or second group shopping sites. And very different from the group shopping stories like Groupon or Snapdeal as they started. We were actually a reverse auction-based retailer, seller-based. So we had a huge reverse auction engine and stuff that was working. But within 3 months of starting it, we realized group shopping has its flaws. We went back, there were a couple of interesting research reports from Stanford around Mop Shop and Mercata, which happened in 2000. Unfortunately, we discovered them after we started. So, and then we were able to kind of validate those results with what we were seeing. It ended up being more e-commerce than group shopping, so we moved on from there. And then eMart happened in 2009. July. So we actually just completed 6 years 10 days back. But I want to start with one of those sentences that Gaurav also said, which is, you need to know what your consumers want or where do you want to take them. There's this really interesting quote of Henry Ford, which says, if you had asked people what they want, they would have told you faster horses, not cars. Right? I had a similar moment, and I actually call it my Maruti moment. All of you would have seen that Maruti ad, brilliant ad, I thought, stayed in my mind, where there's a NASA scientist talking about a wonderful spacecraft, and eventually somebody from the audience says, "Wo sab theek hai, kitna deta hai?" Right? So when we started in 2009 or 2010, early 2010, I was with the CMO of one of the large Fortune 500 companies in Bombay. At that time, I was based in Bangalore. And we were sitting with the CMO, we had all our FAQs, sales pitch, and I'm a career sales guy before entrepreneurship happened. So I was leading the pitch. The CMO heard all our pitch. He had a few questions about the product. We knew what we had to answer. And then he says, "Lekin main consumer data ka karunga kya?" And we were stumped. That was the one question that we didn't plan on. This was, 2008, 2009, 2010 were those early years of internet in India where you would have to go and tell people, internet pe transaction ho sakta hai, right? And we did the job in Govasool, and we started seeing that. But the world has changed. And world has changed how in the last 5-6 years. So that's I've tried to capture some of those either through a couple of anecdotes and some data, and then maybe in the last one slide, just a little snapshot of what we do today. Those of us who are in marketing teams or lead marketing teams or have marketing teams reporting to us know that there's tremendous pressure on all of us as enterprises to drive profitability and to drive growth. And this is from a survey on CMO spend by Gartner, which says that while revenue and profitability is an incredibly important measure, the largest challenge facing marketers today is their inability to connect with customers or to interpret. I'm sure Professor would agree that marketing itself has gone through, like you have web 1.0, 2.0, 3.0. Marketing 1.0 was you would print an ad in the newspaper and the whole country would see the same ad. That was 1.0 in maybe the 70s and the 80s. Then came the era of little bit data. So you started saying surrogating, and I'm going to take a few surrogates, I'm going to look at a little bit of segmentation, I'm going to say SEC, ABC, urban, rural, blah, 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 but you were still doing what is called as broadcasting, which is same message goes to everybody there. Oh, everybody comes to a Taj, must be SEC A, Bombay urban, therefore let's put up a hoarding here outside Taj, right? So that's the world of segmented marketing. the ideal marketing that you'd want if you had the power in your hands as a marketer was to be able to talk to you individually, one-on-one, in a channel that you prefer, in the language that you prefer, at the time that you prefer, with the content that is relevant to you. Right? This is absolutely impossible a few years back. And you know, one of you said, if your idea is not crazy enough, it's not worth it, right? And that beautiful quote that Gaurav left with. So that was our idea, actually. We said, you know, why is it that we are still in the era where, Ogilvy, I think it was Ogilvy who said, I know 50% of my marketing doesn't work, I don't know which half. Right? Marketers still are, you know, they take a bunch of darts and throw them at the wall, hope that a few of them will hit the board. If it hits in one of those rings, then, you know, you're lucky, and oh my God, if it hits your bullseye, then you're getting your promotion, you're getting your incentives and all of that. In fact, I was having a conversation with one of my friends just outside, and you know, how as a marketer, your safest bet is to throw money on an ATL media because you really can't measure. You want to spend a little money on sponsoring an event, there are many, many questions to ask. So marketing is, it was stuck in that world in our view. Right? And the question we were asking ourselves is, you know, I'm a consumer of a product, I walk into a store, I pick a product, the brand does not know Aditya picked the product. The brand only knows Das Peti Bika. Right? This is the world that we are in. So what we thought is this. We said consumers would want to be treated as them, not as a data point in a segment, and not be at the receiving end of a broadcast. Right? So the important thing was, it's, can we help brands get to a point where they don't just look at transactions, which are aggregated information on user behavior, so that we can help them not just broadcast, but get to the user behind the transaction. So this was the thought with which we kind of started eMart. And the last 5 years has been an incredibly, it's been the tipping point or the beginning of the tipping point in the whole explosion of digital interfaces or general transactional interfaces that we see between brands and consumers. You know, you have social media, you have mobile apps, you have QR codes and SMSs and voice and POS, and while all of this is happening on the digital side, 60, 70, 80%, and depending on the country, 90% of real world cash transactions happen in the physical world, not on digital world. So a lot of information gets generated, does not get captured, right? And if you look at the marketing ecosystem, you have many stakeholders for the marketer. You have your internal teams, you have your channel partners, you have your agencies, you have external customers, consumers, influencers. So it's a complex world and transaction happening across complex interfaces, right? So how do you as a marketer really know what is happening? And is there any way for you to know what is happening now as it happens? Most market research agencies that most of the leading companies work with will do a wonderful campaign, or some of the largest advertising agencies or BTL agencies will do a campaign, will give you a report, but 30 days from now. We discovered it how? We were sitting in one of the largest CPG medical devices company in the world. We were sitting in their office in South Bombay. We had this, again, lovely pitch, wonderful pitch. We had all our questions answered, and you know, for us, the main thing in 2009 was we were the only ones who were able to give real-time visibility to transactions happening at the consumer side in a live dashboard. Right? And the guy on the other side said, "Ye toh mereko milta hai." So we were stumped because we knew absolutely there was nobody else who was giving it. After 20 minutes of our discussion, we discovered the meaning of real-time for him was end of campaign, meko report aa jata hai. For us, real-time was now. Through the campaign, right? So terminology, just what is your marketer? So there were a lot of these white elephants in the room that we started seeing when we started getting into these conversations, through which we evolved, of course. But it's a complex world, therefore, on the marketing side. So to us, we said, okay, you need to get seamless data, you need to get accessibility, you need to get real time, but you know, hold on. You know, those of you, at least from IMA, I know, I don't know about the other IIMs, but CCCF, right? All of us have, yeah, contextual clarity and conceptual familiarity, right? We thought that was missing in those interactions between the brand and the consumer. I mean, to me, conceptual familiarity was your ability to be relevant in the content that you were giving, and contextual familiarity is the context of the consumer. And that was missing, right? Because the assumptions are that if say, Hitesh and I are in the same place, we are both at the same point in life, and we want the same things at the same time, which is not true. And we've seen this in our applications. I mean, you know, we've done some very, very interesting customer engagement, channel engagement, sales engagement programs using our platform. And we realized that if two of us have the same level of earnings in terms of, you know, the incentive or loyalty points, depending on whether I'm a consistent performer or an inconsistent performer, my spend pattern completely changes. What kind of brand preferences I have completely changes. Right, so if I'm not able to see that, my marketing message is going to be lost, and it's not going to be relevant. So and the intent of the marketing message is to be able to give the right nudge, so your consumer behaves in a manner that you expect the consumer to behave, and therefore drive a sale or whatever you're after. So to us, that was the opportunity, you know, Gartner kind of also reconfirmed our views, which is marketing heads expected customer experience to be the primary basis of competitive advantage, and they have no clue how to get there. And if you look at the, I hope I'm not getting too technical on everybody, but if you look at how channels of interface are evolving, you know, organizations, and all of us have been working for a number of years in corporate or have worked before we started on our own. We all know the vertical structures in organizations, right? I am marketing, I am sales, I am market research only, and the larger the organization, the more matrix the organization, the more specific those silos become, which means you will not even look at it. And this we've learned it, you know, one thing is to be inside an enterprise, but then when you start selling to the enterprise, you see these barriers a lot more. Right, because you go and talk to a brands guy in a company about a sales program, he will say, what are you doing here? Sorry, wrong guy, go back, right? So, but consumers don't talk to you like that, right? Consumer is doing a transaction with your brand. He doesn't care if you're from brands, he doesn't care if you're from marketing. So there's tremendous amount of convergence that's happening in the consumer mind, and the consumer expects you to be seamless no matter which channel of interface the consumer chooses to communicate with you. Which means if you don't have, as an enterprise, mechanisms to ensure that you are able to follow your consumer footprint across all of these interactions, you're not going to be able to communicate with relevance, right? And that is where we thought the opportunity was, and that is where we've started investing in our platform. It's called First Hive, and you know, we've been able to file a global patent on our platform, and we're building a lot of interesting algorithms on there. But this is really where it is. And I'm trying to avoid using words like omnichannel and all. They're much abused, those of you who are in the industry. And this is one thing that that we strongly feel that enterprises, and we see some enterprises have already started on this journey. They're kind of dismantling their vertical structures, and they're going towards digital first, where there is a digital core to the enterprise, and every external interface of the enterprise feeds information and intelligence back here to this digital core, it processes it, and it instructs the interface as just the interface of communication, not as the thinker, right? It's like the human body. You have one brain, all your hands, legs, all the five senses are not brains. It's just one brain center, right? So that's how enterprises are moving to as well. So anyway, a little bit of theory here, but our belief is, I kind of agree with what Professor Agnihotri as well said, which is if you do not show loyalty to your customer, and your customer cannot be loyal to you, and for you to show loyalty, you have to be able to deliver relevancy in your communication. And relevancy shows in everything, in the choices that you make as a brand. channel, content, everything else, the CCCF bit. So that's pretty much what we had. So what we are building is the whole marketing cloud. We have a couple of interesting applications on that, but what we mostly do is we have our own core technology product, and then we have a bunch of services wrapped around it, because we realize, at least as far as India goes, and in the first 5-6 years, we needed to go deeper into enterprises. So we started delivering in a managed services model. We have some very, very interesting deployments over the last 6 years. We've touched about 200 plus companies with our deployments. And we've been very fortunate in our journey as well. Most of our enterprises have been number one, number two, number three in their respective industries, and we're one of the few companies in the first 5-6 years to also work with a Fortune 1, Fortune 10, Fortune 80 kind of companies. So far, we've probably had an impact of about $2 billion in terms of the amount of business that we've been able to impact. And one of the very few companies, I would believe, who currently has the ability to impact about 10 million consumers through our platform in real time. So it's been a very interesting journey, and all of this runs on our single platform, and we deliver it as a SaaS. The next 2-3 years are going to be very interesting for us as a company, because we are also making our first jump to being an India-only focused company. Our first couple of challenges were to get industry agnostic and stakeholder agnostic, which we've achieved, and now we're looking at geography agnosticity. So we are looking to make our first few jumps beyond India. So that's going to be, I'm hoping, an even more interesting journey as we go through that. But that's pretty much what I had. Thank you.